unapologetical. That is the one word I would use to describe the Qidi Q2. Yeah, it's a printer that's made to a budget, they know it. They're running standard open source software that anyone can use, and Qidi are actually kind of proud of it. And yeah, instead of developing their own design language, it's rather inspired by the Bamboo lineup. Here, I'll show you a couple of close-ups and you tell me which ones are the Qidi Q2 and which are Bamboo. Ready? If you guessed like this, you'd be absolutely wrong. These were all from the Qidi Q2. And actually, I think it's a shame that the vibe Qidi is going for is cheap Bamboo knockoff, because that first impression immediately devalues the printer when it actually has a lot of good stuff going for it. So here's the lowdown on the Q2. This is a fully enclosed and actively heated Core XY style printer with a hardened nozzle that goes up to 370 degrees Celsius out of the box. And it's all run by a standard Klipper setup, which is totally accessible to the user. The machine overall is pretty compact, but has a 270 square build area and goes 256 millimeters tall, so just a little bigger than your standard size printers. You can get the Qidi box with it for filament multiplexing and drying, and the on sale price for the printer is just $450, or $650 with the Qidi box, $500 and $700 regular, which is a segment where you get a ton of choice in printers. Every manufacturer has one, but they all have their own priorities and what they want to do well, and where they skimp out. The Qidi Q2 definitely sits in the high-spec power user sort of niche, which is interesting because the features that make it unique within that group, which are the high-temp nozzle in combination with the heated chamber, mean that if you fill up the Qidi box with the sort of specialty filaments that need those specs, you've instantly got more money in high-end filaments sitting in that box than this whole supposedly entry-level printer is worth. Though testing the Q2 has been a bit of a rollercoaster ride. If you look on Amazon, Qidi printers almost exclusively get glowing 5-star reviews that hit all the major talking points, but my expectations dropped to the floor when I took it out of the box and found what looked like a Dollar Tree version of a shrunk down Bamboo H2D. But then I started using it and found how openly this printer is built on Klipper and how they're doing everything local first without forcing you to sign up for cloud services and the like. And I really enjoy seeing that approach because it means you're not dependent on someone else's services for using the thing that you bought. But then the more I kept using the Qidi Q2, I also kept on finding flaws that were getting harder and harder for me to brush aside. So right now I'm just really torn on what to think about the Q2. I had just tested the Bamboo H2S, and aside from the obvious size difference, specs-wise they're supposed to be surprisingly even. Just that the Qidi Q2 also costs about a third as much. So because the rest of the specs are so similar, I started running it through the same test parkour. First observation, the Q2 is a lot noisier. Input shaping tuning sounds like the tool that is about to fly out the side of the printer, and when it's just idle, it always has a fan running with a pretty annoying noise profile. That's it right there. So I'm actually gonna keep the Q2 turned off for the rest of this video. Though, by default, it actually also prints quite a bit faster than the H2S, and with the right kind of part, like this one, it also gets some pretty respectable quality too, and that was really cool to see, again, especially considering that this is sort of on the value end of 3D printers. To sum up, quality is good and we can move on, right? Well, not so fast. I started off printing PETG with some simpler parts like these, then I moved on to this structural member from Carolyn, and on there I was starting to see some pretty gross artifacting around the bridging area of horizontal holes. Same on these LED panel clamps, but there it's visible wherever the toolhead has to slow down for overhangs and then speed back up for the regular sidewall. But I thought, well, this is Klipper, right? And what I'm seeing is looking a lot like I just need to retune the pressure advance feature. After all, that's something that the Q2 doesn't measure automatically, so I can just give it a double check, right? And to my surprise, in Qidi Studio, you get a tuning tab that will generate a standard tuning tower for you. To dial in just that feature, it gives you instructions on how to do it and where to save the results. I think this is fantastic. Sure, I would still prefer not having to do any tweaking in the first place, but since that's not an option here, I very much prefer Qidi's solution where I'm sort of empowered to do something about the things I don't like, versus, for example, Anycubic's approach, where you get an auto-tune button that doesn't work and no alternative. But it turns out what I was seeing wasn't pressure advance at all. From the factory, the printer is already dialed into precisely the same values that I found, so that's good, but it doesn't fix, you know, this problem. I know I'm kind of dwelling on this one issue, but if this is really the best that the printer can do, everything else just becomes irrelevant. So I tried different profiles, was tweaking speed limits and flow smoothing settings. Ultimately, I reached out to Qidi and asked them if they were aware that their Q2 prints, you know, like this. And they sent me back a tweaked print file that way slows down the machine, and that does eliminate the issue. So it really was just poor default profiles. We'll get back to this in a bit. But of course, the big standout feature of the Q2 is that it can handle some pretty high-temp specialty materials like PEI, PPSU, or PEKK. Those all need this hardened extended temperature range of 370 degrees Celsius. And the only other somewhat affordable printer I could find that goes that hot would be the Eliarchy Alchemy, but that one was a $1,400 printer on Kickstarter that honestly just doesn't look like it's happening. Though the PPS CF that I have doesn't print, I can't get it off rail. This stuff doesn't print quite that hot, and it would actually work fine on many of the other printers that are competing with the Q2, even if just barely, you know, this is like 320 degrees Celsius. But on the Q2, it did print just fine. And it even works with the Qidi box. The Bamboo H2S, for example, doesn't allow loading PPS CF into the AMS because the tight bends that would require, and this stuff is just way too rigid to fit through that. But still, I didn't exactly get the PPS CF part off of the Q2's bed in one piece. The PEI bed material seems to be the same kind that I saw on the Magneto or on my Voron kit. It's a slightly more sort of rubbery feeling type of PEI, while the Prusa and Bamboo beds feel sort of dry and hard. It's hard to describe. This softer feeling type often tends to stick to parts better than the parts layers stick to each other. So on more than one occasion, I've had to scrape away torn off PTG bits with a knife blade, and the little prime line that the printer does at the front got trickier and trickier to remove with every print. It seems like the more you use these beds, the stickier they get, so maybe plan on replacing these eventually. So yeah, I didn't quite get the last print off of this one. On the other end of the extreme, PLA on the Q2 isn't without its issues either. I know this might be my bad, because the instructions on the thing I did wrong are literally printed on the outside of the machine, but I didn't think it would be that bad. On the Core 1 or the Bamboo P and X printers, you should open the door for better ventilation when you're printing PLA. But in my experience, and for a lot of other people as well, you can also just leave it closed and it's fine. But the Qidi Q2 instantly punished me for forgetting to slide open its top and had me tear apart the tool head and picking bits of bulged out PLA out of the extruder for over an hour. Not the most enjoyable experience. I swear I'll be better next time. With that fixed and the top finally open, yes, it prints PLA with the same results as the other filaments. And those results are, again, that those stock profiles are pretty recklessly tuned. The parts have some visible VFAs. The printer doesn't do the motor micro-stepping matching thing with the drivers. There is visible curling on overhang edges, even with PETG. And of course, the flow inconsistencies show up with all materials. I would guess that that is actually due to the hot end struggling to keep up, even though the Q2 is already printing pretty hot. With the slowdown profile that Qidi sent me, much of that disappears, though now the parts are a bit more glossy, the layers don't look as nicely stacked, and ringing and VFAs are a bit more visible. I think this should be the default profile though, but Qidi are still deciding whether they think this is actually better than their default. As it stands, there are printers out there that manage to print better even when running at their full default speed. Qidi gives you a lot of freedom to do what you want with their machine. I just hope it's not just an excuse for diffusing the responsibility of making it print well. Qidi has built a reputation on making, you know, what are sort of like pre-built Vorons. The printer and even the filament box are handled all through just standard Klipper tools, standard macros for, you know, unloading, loading, all of that good stuff. You get full access to the Linux system underneath. You can log in as root through SSH, but you don't have to. Firing up Qidi Studio and just using that also totally works. The only parts that I think are proprietary in this system are the AI detection tool, and as far as I can tell, the software driving the screen. Also the Qidi Link component, which handles remote access, but it's defaulting to doing everything locally anyway. The printer even includes an Ethernet port and a cable for that too, so that's nice. The rest of the hardware is all right, but not super high-end. Not that that's what you should be expecting at that price. The screen is obviously cheap, it has visibly low contrast, low resolution, but, you know, totally serviceable. The camera that's sitting like right here is supposed to be up to 1080p. It is configured to run at 640 by 480, which, you know, is okay for checking in on prints, but time lapses do look like they were filmed in 2005. And for some reason, I had a real tough time finding the promised AI detection. Hey, editing Tom here. One of the jobs that I have after filming a video is to actually double check the stuff that I say. And as it turns out, the AI features are there. They've always been there. They just weren't enabled by default, and I somehow hadn't noticed them before. And the thing that's typically called spaghetti detection, they did translate to fried noodle detection, which I think is awesome. Please don't change this, Qidi. What's cool is that that feature is built to run completely locally on the printer's SoC as well. And it should be able to do spaghetti detection based on a standard object classifier model, but also chamber clearance monitoring at the start of the print. And I did get a chance to try a print with the monitoring on. It already detected an issue, but the print is actually fine. So I think the model still needs a bit of fine tuning. Oh, and the app that goes through Qidi Link, for me at least, did work. But the reason it has 1.7 stars seems to be that it turns off all the fans on the machine every time you use it to check in on a print job. Effectively always ruining that print job in the process. Schrödinger would love this app. Now, I don't actually mind the visibly cheap manufacturing on things like the case itself. Sure, it could be nicer, but it would also make the machine more expensive to build. From what I'm seeing, the parts that are actually responsible for function are built well enough, and that's what matters to me. Finally, I guess I should cover the Qidi box real quick. Again, this is a optional upgrade part, but it does do the 4-filament multiplexer thing, or up to 16 filaments with up to 4 Qidi boxes. It does filament drying, even when printing, which is something that the bamboo AMS can't even do. But temperature control in here seems to be not that great. I set the box to 25 degrees, the printer showed it as 35, and the hotspot in there most likely is well above that. Kind of makes sense that Qidi doesn't allow you to turn on drying when there is PLA loaded. But in general, the experience of using the Qidi box isn't at a level yet where I would really recommend getting one. For swapping filament, you can't just pull it out. You always have to go through the printer screen and wait for it to unload it for you, and then it spits it out with the end just completely loose. You want crossed filament? Because that's how you get crossed filament. And actually using it for a multicolor print went pretty well, until it didn't. At 39%, the printer stopped because one of the filaments had failed to unload. At first, I thought it was like the filament getting stuck in the hotting or something, but it was just the stepper motor inside the Qidi box glitching out for some reason. And then I reached into the poop bin and, well, that shouldn't be in there. I mean, that's a pretty solid chunk that made it down the chute, but usually you don't get parts of metal coming out the back of the printer. The printer's inside was a bit of a mess too, and the rubber nozzle wiper was starting to come off its position, I guess because the little piece of sticky tape holding it in place started giving out. That's also where that metal bar is supposed to be. It's the primary extrusion wiper, held in place only by being poked through that rubber. Thankfully, it doesn't look like anything has been permanently damaged. The wiper slides right back into place, and what is that? Looks like the printer ended up losing a step or two in the process as well, but that must have been a result of everything else that was going on. So, yeah, as a filament dryer or as a single material selector and a convenient way to sync filaments to the slicer, the Qidi box is fine, but I really wouldn't recommend relying on it for multicolor prints to do hundreds of filament swaps. I mean, Not that that's a good idea anyway, because of the, you know, typical insane amount of filament that that process wastes. So honestly, I would just skip the Qidi box entirely and get a separate single filament dry box for what, like 40 bucks, unless you really want the convenience of always having four filaments on tap in your slicer. So what the heck is this printer? I know this is gonna upset some people, but the closest analogy that I came up with is that it's sort of the Linux of 3D printers. In theory, yes, it does all the things any other printer can do, plus so much more, except for the features that aren't done yet, and the ones that don't work, and ones that aren't as good as you hoped for. But you can always submit a pull request if you don't like it, right? Qidi runs a surprisingly good compromise with running a fully accessible Klipper underneath, but still adding just enough of their own tools on top to make it a smooth experience. I fully acknowledge that this is a really tough place to be, and I so prefer Qidi's function-first approach over other solutions that try their best to look polished, but end up being held together by thoughts and prayers. The documentation on the Q2 is surprisingly good, and I can totally look past stuff like the AI detection's not working yet or the app being unusable. That's all bonus. But what needs to work out of the box is the printer being able to produce quality parts. This is one of those situations where software updates and profile tweaks can turn the ship around. Though, as it stands, the Q2 is still more of a hands-on printer than I think it has to be. Links in the description below. But for now, be kind to yourself, keep on making, and I hope to see you in the next one.